your name would say. Hey, you look behind around. Thought just what we need. We are alive now, now. By your name we're free. You got up so I could get up again. Now I'm up again with you. You got up, hey, I could get up again.
Forsake,
say
we really are the
right
thing on earth. more than we in Christian Center. Come on, stand to your feet. Come on, we're going to go forth and worship. If you're excited to be in the room, make some noise. Come on, say, make some noise. Come on, keep clapping my hands like this. Come on. Everybody clap like this. Come on, come on. Clap your hands, yeah. Come on. Everybody clap. Come on. Yes, God, yeah. Hey, our God is mighty and glorious. So we put our trust in your name, Jesus. Yeah. Able to save and deliver us. Yeah. So we put our hope in your name, Jesus. Say blessings and honor, say. Come on, sing it out. Yeah. Unto our God, forever and ever, all of the glory,
all of the honor, all of the
praise. Yeah. It's yours,
yours forever.
Come on, need some energy in the room. Come on, sing it out. Hallelujah. Say.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. We give you the highest praise.
Hallelujah.
Sound to the Lord this morning, yeah. We give you praise, Jesus. Yes, God, yeah. Come on, sing it out, come on. Say, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh.
Steadfast, unmovable. Yeah, nothing's impossible. Cause our God reigns forever, sir. Say.
Our God is in control.
Yeah, he's steadfast. Say.
Steadfast, unmovable.
Nothing's impossible.
Nothing's impossible.
Cause y'all sing it in the room. Come on, sing. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. Sing it out. Say hallelujah. Come on. Hallelujah. Say.
Nothing's impossible.
Our God. impossible for you.
It's
our God reigns. Yes, see, come on. Come on, clap. Come on, I can't hear you. Come on. Clap them hands, clap them hands. Come on. Yeah. Come on, sing it out. Yeah. Say yo.
This every Sunday, we just want to lift up words of affirmation, words of praise, words of praise to you, God. We give you glory. We give you honor. Come on, let me hear your voices. Come on. Come on, lift up a mighty shout. Come on, let me hear your voices. Come on. Come on, come on, yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We give you praise, Jesus. By his stripes, yeah. Said by his stripes. Said we are healed, and by his nail pierced we're free, and by his blood said we're washed clean, and now we have the victory. And the power of sin,
Jesus.
We'll sing it out. He overcame it all. Yeah. Yeah. Cause he has won.
He has won a freedom.
Yes, he has.
Jesus has won
it all. Say.
Oh.
Can we sing this out? Come on. We sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You have won a victory. Oh, we sing
hallelujah.
You have won it all.
So
death could not hold.
Say, hold you down.
Yeah, you're alive and well. You are.
You are the reason. King.
Yeah, and you're seated in. Say, oh God, you are the risen King. Say,
you are the risen King.
One more time around, come on. Yeah. say?
And you're seated in majesty.
You are the risen King.
You are the risen King.
We go sing.
Said our God is
risen. He is alive.
You won.
He won the victory.
And He reigns.
He reigns on high.
Our God is. He's alive, yeah.
He is alive. Come
on, sing it out.
He won the victory.
Yes, He reigns.
He reigns on high.
Our God is alive.
Our God is risen.
He's alive, yeah.
He is alive.
He's alive and well.
He won the victory.
Yes, He reigns.
He reigns on high.
Say, our God is risen.
Our God is risen.
He's alive, yeah. We sing
hallelujah.
You have won a victory. I'm so grateful, Jesus, that You won. Yeah, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Say He has won it all. Yeah. Say death could not hold. Not even death could hold You down, Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah. And He's seated in
majesty.
So You are the risen King.
You are the risen King.
And come on, people of God, come on, lift up your voices, stretch your hands, and worship Him in a room this morning. We give You praise, oh God. We give You praise, oh Jesus. We give You praise, oh God. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, oh, yeah. Come on, follow me, team. Come on, come on, sing. Say, oh, oh, oh.
Oh, oh.
Say, oh, oh.
Oh, oh.
Say, oh, oh. Say oh oh oh,
oh oh oh.
Say oh oh,
oh oh oh.
Say oh oh oh,
oh oh oh.
Oh oh
oh.
Say oh oh oh,
oh oh oh.
Say oh oh
oh.
Say oh oh
oh.
Oh oh oh. Lift the name of Jesus higher. You higher, God. We lift the name Jesus higher. We lift You higher, God. Yes, we lift the name Jesus higher. Yeah. Lift You higher, God. Yeah. Hallelujah. It is, yeah.
And better is one day in Your course. Better is one day.
Come on.
Thousand elsewhere.
to better is. In a thousand, sing it out loud, say better is. Thousand elsewhere, better is. Oh, yeah. Better is one. Thousand elsewhere, say better is one day. Better is a. Sing it, I'll say. Say better is one day. Say better is one day. Say better is one day. Better is. Say better is one day. Better is one day, Jesus. Than thousands elsewhere. Yeah, than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one. Better is a, so better is one day. Come on, team, help them. Come on. Say better is one. Better is. Say better is one day. Than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day. Better is one day. Better is one day, yeah, than a thousand. Say better is one day. Better is one day in your courts. Better is
one day in your house.
Say better is one day
in your
than a thousand elsewhere. Say better is
one day in your
house. Better is
one day in your house.
Better is one day. Then a thousand, one more time. Better is one day.
Better is one day in your court. Better is one day in your house.
Better is one day
in your
court. Than a thousand elsewhere. Say better is
one day in your
court.
Better is one day in your house.
Better is
one day in your court. A
thousand elsewhere. Voices, come on. No, come on, no clapping, just voices. Come on, just your voices. Sounds of worship, sounds of praise, sounds of worship, sounds of praise. Come on, we push through this morning, Jesus. We push through every situation. Come on, it don't matter what you're dealing with. Come on, we push through. And we give you praise despite of our situations, Jesus. Despite of our circumstances, Jesus, you're still worthy. Ah. Oh.
Jesus, take control. Yeah, take control. Jesus, take control of our lives, God. Take control. Jesus, take control. Yeah, say, take control. Jesus, take control. Say, take control. Take control. Jesus, take control. Say, take control of our lives, God. Say, take control. Jesus, take control. Yeah. Say, take control. Jesus.
Come on, stretch your hands and sing. Come on, talk to your situation.
Take control.
We put our focus on you, Jesus.
Say, take control.
Say, take control, Jesus.
Jesus, take control. Say, take control, God. Jesus, take control.
Jesus, take control. Take control. Jesus, take control. I hear that so clearly. Come on, sing it.
Take control. Jesus, take control. Take control.
Jesus, take control. Come on, I need a few more rounds of that. Come on, say, take control.
Say, take control.
Say, take control, yes. Say, take control, say.
Take control.
Say, take control, God, of our lives, of our situations, of our families, God, take
control. Take
control. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
I feel the Holy Spirit releasing some things. And in order for you to receive it, you're going to have to release some things to him. Some things that you have not been able to fix or work out just in the presence of God. We want the Holy Spirit to have his way. You've been in control long enough and it's not working. You've been trying to work some things out that God is calling you to release. And then sometimes we're trying to release some things that God is calling us to work out. And so there's a divine order. And so right now, I want you to exchange burdens. Jesus says that my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And then he says that we should cast our care upon him. And so there's a sweet exchange. There's an anointing and there's a grace that is being released right now in worship. The thing I love about worship, worship is not your work. It's thanking God and receiving what he's done. So LaZar, we're gonna sing that some more. Take control, Jesus. Take control. Take control, Jesus. Control. Take control, Jesus. We want you to take over where we've been in worship. Just release. Thank you, Jesus. Go ahead and just release some things. Release your children that you've not been able to control, but God can get to them. Release your finances to him and step into that place of obedience. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
control.
Yes, yes, yes. Release it.
Take control, Jesus. Take control.
Hallelujah.
Say, take control, Jesus. Take control. Say, take control. Say, sing it out. Take control, Jesus. Take control, God. Yeah. Yeah. Say, take control, God. Yeah. Take control, Jesus. Take control. Say, take control. Jesus, take control. Say, take control. Say, take control, Jesus. Yeah.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Now give it up. Give
say,
it up.
Take control. Say,
give it up. Release
control.
It. Release it. Release it.
Release, release the sound it. In the atmosphere.
Release it. Release it.
Take
release
control.
It.
Control. Jesus, take control. Oh. Say, take control, Jesus.
Take control.
Yeah. Say, take control, Jesus. There's just one name I know, it's Jesus Christ, oh. There's just one name I know, it's Jesus Christ, oh. If he said it so, it will be so. Said if he said it so, it will be so. If he said it so, it will be so. If he said it so, it will be so. If he said it so, it will be so. It's not just words on a page, but you're a true living Jesus. You're a true God. You're the living word, Jesus. You're the living word, God. You're still doing miracles today, Jesus. Oh, if you said it so, it will be so, Jesus. Oh, yeah. Healing in the atmosphere. Healing in the atmosphere. Breakthrough in the atmosphere. Healing in the atmosphere. Breakthrough in the atmosphere.
We receive.
Healing in the atmosphere.
We receive. We receive. We receive. We receive.
Healing in the atmosphere.
Go ahead and receive the dispensation of the grace of God. Receive it by faith. Receive it. Take it. Take it. Take it.
Hallelujah.
Divine empowerment. Divine enablement where you failed. We receive it, we receive it, we receive it. We receive it. Your grace is sufficient. Your strength is made perfect in our weakness. We can't do a thing without you, oh God. We thank you, Lord God, that you love us with an everlasting love and that you are moved toward us with compassion this morning. And it's in your love and it's in your mercy where we find strength and healing and deliverance and freedom. It's already been provided. It's already been paid for. And so what we say, Lord, is yes, we receive it. Yes, we receive it. Get real focus on what you're believing God for. Get real focus on what God has to do. And then see Jesus hanging on the cross, saying over you and over your life that it is finished. Receive God's love, that it's a done deal, that God has already paid for what you can't. And say, I receive it now in Jesus. And whatever it is, be focused now. You can't be general, be specific. He that comes to God must believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. I receive it now. I receive it. I receive it now. In Jesus' name, I thank you, Lord God. I thank you right now for your faithfulness. I thank you for your love. I thank you, Lord, that in your sovereignty, you are God, and in your sovereignty, you have chosen to love a wretch like me. Couldn't earn your blessing. Don't deserve your goodness. But I thank you. I thank you, Lord, for your love. I thank you, Lord, for your mercy, which endures forever. Your mercy has not run out. Your grace is sufficient. Your grace is more than enough. Hallelujah. Just go ahead and thank him. Go ahead and thank him from the bottom of your heart. Thank him for his faithfulness. Look back, take a moment to see. Get a revelation of the goodness of God. Get a view of the mercy of God. He's so good.
I'm still in your hands.
Thank you, Jesus.
This is my confidence.
Hallelujah.
You never fail. Your promise still stands.
Worship him.
Great is your faithfulness.
Hallelujah.
Your faithfulness.
Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord.
I'm still in.
Jesus. Flesh cry out to you, the living God. You are our rock, you are our fortress, you are our deliverer, you are our shield, our defense, our strong tower. When our heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. And so we run to you, Lord. We run to you because you are a good Father. Because you never fail. Because we are loved children. Thank you, Lord, that you have visited and redeemed your people, raised up a horn of strength in the house of your servant David, that we might be delivered from the hand of our enemies and from the hand of those who hate us, that we can serve you without fear. And so we say, Lord, blessed be your name. From this time forth and forevermore, may your name be praised. Thank you, Lord, for honoring us with your presence. And we're careful, Lord God, not to hold back, but to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise in Jesus' name. Give God a clap offering of praise for his goodness and for his wonderful work to us, the children of men. His works are marvelous in our eyes. Taste and see that the Lord is good. He's a shield and a buckler. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God is so good. He's so faithful. He is so, so worthy. So I was glad when they said unto me, let's go to the house of God. I want you to know that there is an anointing in this place. It's a corporate anointing when we come together. You could have been beat up all week, feeling discouraged and feeling drained. And I'm reminded of that woman in Mark chapter 5. She has an issue of blood that causes her to be weak all the time. But in her weakness, she makes it to Jesus. And by her making it to Jesus and pressing through, the healing virtue flowed from Jesus into her. Well, I want you to know, in a similar way, there is a corporate anointing that you experience. You experience when you come into the house of God. Some of you, you might have come in and you might have come in with a pain and just burden. And sometimes you don't even realize that there's a release that's taking place. And you check yourself and the pain is gone. The discouragement or the depression or what it is that it's gone. That's because of the holy healing anointing that's in the atmosphere. All of a sudden you are encouraged and you feel built up and you feel refreshed. That's the presence of God. The Bible says times of refreshing come. Sometimes you just have to get to the house of God where the people are praying. You just got to get here. Thank you, Jesus. Well, we are glad, we are excited, we are worshiping, and before we celebrate the table of the Lord, we're going to get ready to do that in a moment, but before we do that, we're going to have some special announcements that we want you to pay attention to. Thank you and welcome for those of you who are viewing online. God bless you. Stay tuned. The best is still yet to come. Amen.
I would love to say an extra special welcome to you. We pray that you are blessed in today's service and that you come back and join us again. In times like these, it's really important that we stay connected and informed. So here's a rundown of everything you need to know about what's happening here at WCC. Hi, are you new to our WCC family? Welcome to you. Please join us for anything you hear in today's announcements. If you are joining with us in person, please visit us in our guest lounge directly after service. We would love to say hello. Our Aurora campus would like to invite all who are available to come together to minister to our community and fellowship with our church family every Wednesday night through the end of March. Join us for dinner from 5:30 p.m. to 6:45 p.m. At 7 p.m., Pastor Lawrence will share a message on 10 fundamental laws of Christian leadership. We would love to see you in the house. There is a lot happening here at WCC. Mark your calendars for these upcoming events. Interested in learning more about WCC? We invite you to register to attend Growth Track, which will be held on Sundays at our Carroll Stream campus at 9 a.m. This will be a great way to learn the history of our ministry and find out how you can be a part of the wonderful things that God is doing here. Visit us today in the lobby or sign up on our Church Center app. Would you like to take the next step in your faith journey? Our next service of baptism will be held on Sunday, March 19th at our Carroll Stream campus. Be sure to register on the Church Center app for next Sunday's baptism class to hear the important information that you need to know about taking the next step. Are you looking for ways to do life together? We encourage you to join our Connect groups. This is a fantastic opportunity to learn and grow alongside members of your WCC family. Our next session starts this week, so visit our website to find a group today. Join us for our special Foundations of Biblical course with Dr. Dina Marie Carr. This will be a four-part series that will transform the way you view your financial resources. Whether you are a seasoned investor or a novice, this course is for you. Register on the Church Center app to reserve your spot today. Be sure to join us Friday at 7 p.m. for our next Ladies' Prayer. This will be a powerful opportunity to pray and worship with your sisters in Christ. Thank you so much for joining us today. If you missed out on any of our announcements, be sure to visit our website and our social media site to stay up to date. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Praise the Lord again. This is Communion Sunday, where we celebrate the table of the Lord. And this is a sacred thing that we do, in which we remember what was done for us, the redemption, and what it cost our Savior for us to be redeemed. And so I'm going to ask those who have been assigned to come and help to administrate the table of the Lord to please come now. I want to remind you that on Communion Sunday, we also remember those who are in need, and this is an opportunity for us to do something extra toward missions and benevolence. Amen. The table is the Lord's. The feast is for his disciples. Let all those who with true repentance have forsaken their sin and look to Christ alone for salvation partake in this holy observance for their soul's comfort and delight.
For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes."
Hallelujah, Father. You allowed your precious Son to step out of eternity to walk amongst us, to go about doing good and healing all that were sick and oppressed of the devil. You came to set the captive free. We're thankful, Lord God, that you stretched out your arms as they beat you and bruised your body. You could still say, "Father, forgive them." Thank you for finishing the work that you set out to do, dying on the cross, shedding your blood, that our sins, and how great were our sins, that we could be forgiven. And we're thankful today that we can come and partake together and bring into remembrance what you've done, the price you paid, the heavy price you paid for our sins. Hallelujah. We're going to partake together. You can remove the cellophane from your communion elements. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you, preserve you blameless in divine health unto everlasting life. Our Savior himself said, my flesh is food indeed. Food is that which does a body good. You can receive your healing today. Let us take and eat and feed on him in our hearts by faith. Let us walk in divine health and live before God and man pleasing. Let us take and eat and truly be thankful.
Precious blood in all this world. God, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is pleasing through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us take, drink, knowing that the Savior's blood effects the remission or sending back of our sin. Let us boldly approach the throne of grace, that we might obtain mercy and find help in our time of need. Let us drink and let us be truly thankful. Hallelujah. Thank God for the blood. Amen. You may stand as we continue in worship.
Within your presence, I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire. Jesus, over fear and all anxiety, to every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. Your name, Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Oh, shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, yeah. Jesus. Speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Come on and lift up your worship to the Lord. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We love to sing your name. We love to call on the name of Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. We love you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Glory to the name that is above every name, the name of Jesus. Demons tremble at the name of Jesus. And he says to his disciples, in my name, you're going to tread upon serpents and scorpions. And the tactics and trickery of the enemy will not be able to hurt you because of that name. Give God another clap offering of praise. You may be seated. Yes, you are so right. Sometimes that's the first time you've ever been right.
We tried to coordinate, but
yeah. Yes, well, praise God. We know the presence of God is just here and it's just thick in the place. And God is good. God is good. As some of you know, a couple weeks back we had a business meeting and some of you submitted questions, and we just wanted you to know that those of you who submitted questions, we have a response for you in room 133 after the service. So thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. I just want to add a welcome to those of you who are visiting with us for the very first time. We want to say welcome to WCC, and we're so excited and delighted that the Holy Spirit led you here this morning. So we want to say welcome to you. Church family, let's give our guests a welcome. Amen, amen. And as you heard in announcements after service, please join us in the guest lounge, which is just right across the way, or look for somebody who might know, like they know something, one or two things, and ask them where the guest lounge is, and they will direct you there. We just want to welcome you. We have just a special gift to say thank you for worshiping with us this morning. I just want to come up here also and remind ladies, we will not be having an all-night prayer. So say, but we'll be praying from 7 to 11. All right, this Friday, 7 to 11, we'll have worship, we're praying, and you know, there's something special that happens when women pray. I honestly believe that God has a special hotline for us women when we pray. So I encourage you to come here on Friday night, right in here in the sanctuary, 7 p.m. We'll be praying over ourselves, our families, our, you know, our nation, our church, and the things like that. We'll be praying here. So make sure that you're coming out Friday from 7 to 11 p.m., And then our Connect groups are launching this week. So this is our small group. This is a small group meetings, right? Small group meetings. So if you don't know what groups are happening, you can go on the Church Center app and you can download and see what groups are happening, or go to the guest lounge and somebody will be able to assist you. But we want to encourage you to join a Connect group. And if you'd like to lead a Connect group, it's not too late for you to do that. Just go again in the guest lounge and they'll be able to help you, direct you to where you need to go. And
amen, amen, praise the Lord. Ooh. Amen, praise the Lord. God bless you.
You see how he does me?
God bless you.
You see how he does me?
Amen.
I never
give
knew
Pastor
like
Fiona
this.
A hand. Just so lovely, wonderful announcements there. All right. I'm looking at the clock. I don't know who else is, so I got to go. Let's jump into the Word of God, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you. We bless you. You are a good God. And we're enjoying the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Speak to us, Lord, as we're here to receive and to respond in obedience to your Word. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to just add my word of encouragement for you to make sure, if you have not picked up a legacy fact sheet where you can jump in and get on board with what your church is doing. And we are thinking beyond ourselves. There are some things that we're taking care of in the house, and I encourage you to get involved and do what you can, do what God tells you to do to help support the work of God that we are engaged in. And so make sure that there's a drop box there before you exit, that you pick up one of those legacy folders. And we don't just, we know that this is a year of greater capacity, so we are being stretched in areas, but we believe in this church in cultivating, training up God's people, building up God's people to do the work of the ministry. And so we have made it possible for you to receive training in kingdom stewardship, for you to maximize what God has given you and use your gifts, your talents, your resources, understand stewardship at a higher level. And so this is something you must take as a priority for yourself, and limited space is available, so do get registered. I encourage you to obey God in giving and receiving. In this church, we believe in putting God first, and that is by way of tithes and offerings. And so go ahead and obey God. There are four ways to give. Make sure you fully say yes in this area. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your people. I speak your blessing over every heart that is stretched toward you in giving and receiving. And we thank you, Lord, that as we make kingdom our priority, all these things, and you know what things we have need of before we ask, are added unto us. And we see, Lord God, great impact even all over the world as your people are honoring and obeying you in tithes and offerings. In Jesus' name. All right. I want to continue on Free the Flow. This is part two of Free the Flow. The scripture that we are jumping off for, and it's really been a theme this year, Psalm 133 and Acts chapter 4. And just so that we're all together, I'll just go ahead and read a couple verses of Acts chapter 4, verse 32. Now the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and one soul, neither did anyone say that the things he possessed was his own. But they had all things in common, and with great power the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. That's what we are stepping into as an end time church. You are stepping in and you are walking in great grace. I don't know if that's a newsflash for some of you, but that is what's on you. And that's what God has called you to walk in. And that is what you will need to accomplish the purpose of God for your life. You will need great grace. I just need someone just to say great grace. Yes, there could be a mountain of impossibility before you. But the Bible says that it's not by might. That's your ability, that's your strength, that's your know-how, that's your resources. That's not how it's going to happen. That's not how the supernatural is going to be released. Not by your ability. Your strength, the arm of flesh, will fail. It's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by my spirit. Remember in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit is outpoured. And that's how great grace became available, because the Holy Spirit was outpoured upon all flesh. 3,000 souls were saved in Acts chapter 2, which took us to Acts chapter 4, where we see now the manifestation of this great grace. And the mountain that stands before you, the Bible says, will become a plain, will become leveled. That's why through great grace, that impossibility or that difficulty that is before you, that impossible challenge that says you're not going to get beyond this point, becomes a plain. You shall say to this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in your heart, but believe that those things which you say shall come to pass, and you're going to have whatsoever you say when you are speaking with one voice, when your words are the words of God, when you're speaking the word only and you're speaking what's in line or what's in sync with what heaven declares, when you come into agreement, now the flow is open. I shared with you last week about the incident I had with the toilet in Lost. But I want you to know I stand today victorious. Because this week they got the jet stream in there. And they blew whatever was blocking, going 200 feet deep, they blew it out the water. And so we're going to draw some parallel truths. And we're going to get the jet stream to mess with the blockage that is causing the stench. So we from there went to Malachi chapter 4. And we're drawing some connections here. It says, behold, I send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the earth with a curse. God told man in the beginning to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and take dominion. Fill the earth with his image, as man who is made in the image of God took dominion. The glory of God was to be revealed in the earth that God created. But because sin came in, it blocked what God originally intended. And so God had to deal with the blockage that is the sin problem. The Bible says again in Isaiah that the arm of the Lord is not short that it can't save. It says in chapter 59, nor is his ear heavy that he can't hear, but the iniquities have separated. Your iniquities, the impurity, the stench in your life is creating separation between you and God. So Jesus comes and dies on the cross to deal with the blockage. That's the sin problem. That's the one thing that we all have in common and no one wants to talk about. Jesus came and dealt with that. And God says he's going to have to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to the fathers, because unless that happens, the earth is going to begin to stink and rot. And that's what we're seeing in the culture today. That's what we're seeing when we see murder, senseless murder, where we see the homeless man is there just sitting there, and the world has become so evil. The culture has become so sick. People are so demon-possessed that just in broad daylight, the guy is just going to calmly load his gun and for no reason whatsoever, just shoot the homeless man. That's the kind of evil that should shock us to the core and make us as a nation get on our face before God and say we have sinned. This is the earth being smitten with a curse. And God has called you to be the light of this world that is in darkness. Your children are called to be signs and wonders in the earth. God has ordained that his people are the solution to the issues and the challenges that are facing us. So God says, in order to address the curse, I'm going to deal with some things that are blocking. The blessing, the flow of grace is not flowing from the fathers to the children. And on the contrary, the fathers have sown sour grapes and the children's teeth are now set on edge. The fathers, instead of transmitting the blessing, are transmitting generational curse, generational dysfunctional patterns of behaviors that are being taught. So even when we pray our Father, some of us don't even have a concept of a godly father. And that's why many of you don't trust God, because you couldn't trust your earthly father, which was to be a natural example for you to look to God. God uses a natural example and causes you to be born into a natural environment that would cause you to open up to the things of the Spirit like a flower to the sun and open your heart to God and worship God as your father, because you have a point of reference. But when that's not there, the things that God has set in order for structure, for safety, to open your eyes and to bring you up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, you miss that. And so now God is saying, before I come back, I'm going to release an Elijah anointing in the earth. Elijah was bold. Elijah was fearless. Elijah spoke truth to power. He spoke truth to the people. He spoke truth to people who thought that they were all that simply because they were the physical descendants of Abraham. And John the Baptist, who comes in the spirit of Elijah, says, don't be impressed with your heritage. Don't be impressed with your ethnicity. Don't be impressed with your ethnicity. Man, this is 2 weeks in a row. The brothers got to get it together. It's okay. All right, it's okay. We're still together here. Let me go ahead and get on your nerves. He says, don't get there and start to be proud about your blackness or about your whiteness. Oh, yeah, I know. I'm black, I'm proud. I'm black, I'm proud. I'm black, I'm proud. They said, don't bring that mess in the kingdom. Don't be impressed because you're a Jew, because God is able from these stones to raise up sons of Abraham. I'm black, I'm proud. I'm black, I'm black. No, you're a child of the king first. You're a kingdom citizen first. We've adopted the world's mentality, and now we've created idols. I'm not there yet. It's further. It's in the notes. Go check your Bible app. It's in there. But y'all ain't ready yet. I still got to prepare the ground. Because if I preach it too quick, the flesh is going to rise up. And so I got to prepare the ground before we deal with the flesh. The grace, there's a flow, and it flows through faith. it flows, I want to say it flows through sowing. There's a grace that flows through sowing. Hosea chapter 10, verse 12 says, sow for yourselves righteousness. Reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground, for it's time to seek the Lord till he comes and rains righteousness on you. Last week, we were talking about some things that need to be disrupted. Break up the fallow ground. We talked about some things that are blocking, and they will continue to block until they are broken up, until they are disrupted. For the flow of grace to be released, there are some things that have to be disrupted because the enemy has put up some roadblocks that are standing in the way between you and the grace of God being manifest in your life. And the kingdom of heaven suffers violence from the days of John the Baptist until this present time, and the violent take it by force. Sometimes you have to get your football on and you have to run through a troop. You have to run through people who are blocking you and standing in the way of what God is calling you to do. Dude, you can't just be passive and walk in this level of grace. It's not for the passive. It's not for the passive aggressive. It's not for the people who just are hoping and wishing. No, it's the people who are willing to go through a troop. As the mighty man of David in 2 Samuel chapter 24, when the enemy, the Philistines, were blocking the water supply, there were three men of excellence. Are there any men of excellence in the house? Because we know that is going to be the key to God bringing restoration to the culture. It's going to be the men of excellence standing up. God's going to turn the hearts of men of excellence so that the blessing can be properly distributed in divine order. Three men of excellence broke through the barrier. There's a grace, there is anointing that is to be released, but there's blockage. Just like the toilet was blocked up and everything stunk, because there's blockage, everything stinks. Cutting you off from the supply of God, cutting you off from the resources of God, cutting you off from purpose, cutting you off. And so you're living where they tell you to. Your life is subject to what people have said, what your teachers have said, what your parents spoke to you in anger. Your life is stuck around those barriers. Barriers can be shaped by words. The same way God creates by words, by faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, man made in the image of God. Faith is a word in your mouth that you believe in your heart based on God's word, endorsed by the Holy Spirit and acted upon. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for. I got it right this time. So, we're going to have to break through some things. You've got to see there is a real live devil and there is resistance blocking you from your children. Show me. What's the verse that says there's a generational gap between you and your kids? There's a generational gap, right? They told us there's a gap. They told us there's a gap and you can't reach them because there's a gap. That gap is demonic. It's not in the word of God. It's not what God intended, but we've just accepted it. And so, God did not give any children to the government, but yet we give our children to the government and expect the government to raise them and to give them and to train them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. That's why in this church, it is the father that dedicates that child to Christ. Because the Bible says that fathers are to bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. He's going to look to the father first. And it's a big job, so he needs a lot of help. And so, like the Holy Spirit, Jesus says, I'm going to give you help. The Holy Spirit is Jesus' other self. So,
for my children if I say something and my wife says something to them, they heard from my other self in my wife because we're one. Don't let them mess with you because you got to watch them. They're trying to divide and conquer. They go to the one that's going to give them the answer that they want. Husband and wife, you guys got to stay one. You guys got to stick together. So, you know, some of you, you're outnumbered. So you really got to stick together. They should not be able to create any separation. You are one. So, as the word of God says, my son, don't forsake. Heed the instruction of your father in Proverbs chapter 1, and don't forsake the law of your mother. The father and the mother in the Proverbs are saying the same thing. Father gives the instruction, and the mother is enforcing in the home. Agreement. They try to separate you from your children and say, have private conversations. When we take our children to the doctors, those that are underage, sometimes they say, no, they're going to go by themselves. No. Whatever you're going to say to them, we can hear it together because they're not grown. I want to hear everything. If it's a daughter, I'll wait until they change and come back. But then let's talk. We want to hear what? Ain't no secrets. We're not going to create any separation. So a lot of parents, they have not recognized their children when they sent them because the enemy used the system of government to create separation and teach them something different than the values that you wanted to impart. And you have to be very aware. He creates blockage. Some things you have to disrupt. Some things you have to break up when it's blocking. Break up the fallow ground. Sow for yourselves righteousness. There's a grace that is released through sowing. When you sow, it has a way of causing the ground to begin to adjust and things in the ground move in response to the seed. The ground begins to react when you are sowing. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 7 says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. If I want to reap the flow of God's grace, I need to sow. Sow to yourselves. It says, sow to yourselves righteousness. You notice at the end of Hosea 10:12, it says, righteousness is going to reign. Righteousness is going to reign, but the rain doesn't come until you sow into righteousness, until you invest into righteousness. You can't reap a harvest of righteousness when there is no seed sowing into righteousness. Now, this is where it gets kind of ugly because sowing is painful. Psalm 127 says that those that sow in tears shall reap in joy. When you sow, it is painful. But I encourage you, you can't look to the wind or you can't look to your flesh to determine how you are going to invest. You have to determine to sow. You have to determine to sow. Sowing releases some things. The grace can't flow where there's no investment.
The outpouring of God's Spirit can't flow where there's no investment. I want you to know there are many ways in which you can sow. You can sow tears in intercession. And the Bible says God collects them. There are seeds that are sown in prayer. Every day, my wife and I are in the morning, we're calling you out before the Lord. We're speaking to those of you who are going to work and going to school. We're speaking God's blessing. So when you receive the promotion and you're in this anointing, just know that it's not because you're so good, but you have people that are praying for you. You have people that are believing God for things to happen and for things to move in your life. Some of you who are in leadership, we call out by name because something has to happen. As you are engaged and you are giving yourself, something has to happen. The word of God cannot come back void. God's word will accomplish that thing to which he sent it. It's going to prosper in the thing that he pleased. You've got to keep on sowing. Even when you feel like you don't have anything, find something to sow. There was a widow woman, and she is the one that was the exception to the rule. Jesus talks about her in Luke chapter 4 when he comes to his own town and he opens a book, reads from Isaiah that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me to preach the good news, the gospel to the poor, recovering of sight to the blind. He says this and sits down, and everyone in his hometown is looking at him like, who do you think you are? And then Jesus goes on to say there were many widows who were the descendants of Abraham during the time of Elijah the prophet. There were a whole lot of widows that were good Jewish people, good Hebrews. But the prophet was not sent to any of them except a widow from Zarephath. And he comes, the prophet Elijah comes to the widow, and there's a 3-year famine. Everybody is dying. And he comes to her and says, bake me a cake as fast as you can. Now, this whole time, while everyone's starving, he has been fed well by the ravens. He was by the brook, and the ravens were feeding him while everyone else was starving. So he's full, because all he's been doing is sitting there by the brook, enjoying the hot weather by the brook, and he's drinking by the brook, and he's being fed by ravens. I like to say, the ravens, that's an unclean bird. And that just reminds me, this is just a side note, that the Bible says the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the righteous. I believe the ravens were stealing food from the sinners and flying it over to bring to the man of God. So while everyone is in famine, while everyone is experiencing economic disaster, when everyone is having discussions about bad times, the man of God has been eating good the whole time. He's been eating sumptuously. I like to believe, I know I'm stretching the text a little bit, but I just like to believe that the man of God was just making his order when he got up in the morning. What do I feel like today? And the ravens were taking that and bringing it to him. There was a wicked man turned around and his plate was empty. Brought it to Elijah. Ravens, that's an unclean bird, bringing it to Elijah. So by the time Elijah gets to this widow woman and her son who are about to eat their last, he has been full the whole time. They have been starving. He's been eating. And this pot-bellied preacher comes to the widow and he says, I want you to give me mine first. The same way God says concerning the increase that he's blessed you with. He wants to see the blessing released. He wants to see, the windows of heaven, they're open, and God is wanting to release it upon you, and he's waiting for you to obey him. He's waiting for you to respond in obedience to his word, because when you obey him, then the heavens are released upon you. Some of us, we are afraid to obey, but Terry never say, just obey. Just obey. It's better when you obey. So the man of God comes and says, give me mine first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. So she honors the prophet according to the scriptures. She receives a prophet's reward. And so the little bit of oil and the little bit of flour that she would have eaten and died, it's now multiplied because the grace is open. And she not only feeds herself, she feeds everyone in the family. And I like to believe that if there's such thing as supply and demand, I like to believe, but by the time the famine was over, she had a profit. Because if anybody wanted something to eat and she's the only one that has food, family gets a discount. I don't know. I tend to doubt that those cakes were all for free for everybody who's now family. I like to believe that she ended up better. She was better off. God sustained, but she had to sow to release it. She had to give of herself. She had to release what she was trusting in. What is it that you're holding on to that God is saying, I want that? You guys remember the rich young ruler? He had a lot, but he left empty. He left with nothing because he was holding on to. God is saying, release it. There was a centurion. He was a devout man, and the grace of God was outpoured upon his house because he respected the Jewish people, and he gave alms to the poor. And God says, I've heard you. And things started to move out of the ordinary. God says, if I have to give the Apostle Peter a vision to get to you, because of your giving, because of the way you sow, because you are obedient to release what God is calling you to release for the advancement of his kingdom, because you care about the things of God, where your treasure is, there will your heart be. I'm going to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, where the fathers begin to give back, where the fathers begin to pour in. I'm going to turn the hearts. And so because the heart of Cornelius was such, things began to turn in his favor, so that Peter, although he didn't go to a Gentile's house, never been to a Gentile's house, didn't eat what Gentiles ate, Peter was a good God-fearing Jew. And he says, I have never put in my lips what is unclean. And God says to Peter in a vision, what I have cleansed, don't you dare call unclean. And so God is able to move, as Pastor says, heaven, earth, and hell to get to you. I encourage you to open up the flow through sowing. As you sow, the flow is released. As you give, what is the Holy Spirit telling you to release for the advancement of his kingdom that requires you to put your trust in God? Those that trust in riches are going to fail. How hard it is for those who put their trust in what they have, in what they know, to enter the kingdom. It's your Father's pleasure to give you the kingdom. But God is saying, will you trust me? Will you trust me with what is precious to you? Am I first in your life? Am I first? Am I your priority? Tells Abraham, the son of promise that you prayed for, that you waited all these years for, the son that you love, Isaac, I want you to sacrifice him. And you know the story, that Abraham was getting ready to, and the angel of the Lord cried out and said, don't touch the lad, don't touch the boy. And a voice from heaven came. God said in heaven, now I know, Abraham, that you believe me. I know because of your willingness to sow that you really are not going through the church thing, but you really are trusting me with your life in giving Isaac. He's trusting God. Abraham is trusting God with his future. All of Abraham's future was in his child. His hope for the promise was in his child. And God says, I want you to trust me with that. And when Abraham trusted God, God solemnly swore by himself, in blessing, I'm going to bless you. In multiplying, I will multiply you. Let me go there. I'm about to shut it down. Because, you know, Pastor Fiona, she took all my time. We said Genesis 21, is that right? 22, if you were in the spirit, you would know that. Genesis 22. In verse 17, in blessing, this is after. I remember said the grace, it opens up with sowing. Holding back blocks it. Holding back and releasing what God, the Holy Spirit, is telling you to release is going to block it. When you open it, it releases heaven to pour out. The same way heaven was released upon Cornelius' house, and because of his giving, Peter came to his house and the Holy Spirit fell, and all of Cornelius, all of his friends, all of his children got saved, baptized, and filled with the Holy Spirit in one instant. It releases something. Sow in righteousness. Reap mercy. It's by his mercy that you're not consumed, because his compassions fail not. Until he rains righteousness, where there's been so much depression, depravity, dysfunction in your house, righteousness now begins to reign because you've sown righteousness, because you prioritize the kingdom. Abraham has prioritized the kingdom, and he's been willing to sow his only son. And he says, in blessing, I will bless you. In multiplying, I will multiply you. This thing now is being released. Do you see, this is where you see in Malachi, the curse is manifested in the children. You're seeing something different than the curse being manifest in the earth. You're seeing, I will multiply your descendants as the stars of heaven. There's a blessing now because Abraham was willing to offer up his son. God is giving Abraham many sons. God says this, I'm sorry, you got to read verse 16 to really get the text to see why this is happening for Abraham. It's because he did not withhold. God is going to release blessing like the sand of the sea descendants. His family is going to flourish. His children are going to be all right. In verse 18, in your seed, all the nations, your children are going to be blessings to the nations. Hallelujah. They're world leaders. All the nations of the earth shall be blessed because you have obeyed my voice. When I told you to release him, you released him. You didn't hold back. You sowed in tears. You sowed in tears. And now because of your obedience, because you went through the valley, because you went through the tears, and even though the tears wanted to make you stop, you ignored your tears and said, I'm going to obey God even if I'm crying in obedience. I'm still going to obey God. In your seed, all the nations of the earth. So Abraham returned after God releases this blessing from heaven. Check this out. Now it came to pass, verse 20, after these things it was told, after Abraham was getting ready to offer up his son Isaac, and God spoke and released blessing. I just want you to see this before I shut it down in the word, how the flow is released. For years, this passage of scripture didn't make any sense. It's like it's anticlimactic. Here you have all this drama of him offering up his son, and then, are we together in Genesis 22, verse 20? Are we there? It says, so it came to pass after these things that it was told Abraham, saying, indeed, Micah has borne children to your brother Nahor. Huz, his firstborn. Who are these people anyway? Who cares? I mean, God is just saying, stood up in heaven and said, blessed, I'm going to bless you and multiply, I'm going to multiply you and in your seed, all the family of the earth shall be blessed. What's this? I mean, who are these people? Huz? Your cuz, Huz? His firstborn, Buzz? His brother? Kemuel, father of Abraham, Chesed, who's he? Hazo, Pedash. What's all this? 23, Bethuel. I mean, this is really getting, wait a second. And Bethuel begot, wait a second. We see in verse 20, when Abraham offered up his son, was willing to offer up his son, and God says in blessing, I'm going to bless you, there was someone that had a message. Because they had to tell Abram, and these people are far away. This stuff is happening far away. So you see in your Bible that it was told to Abraham. Someone came with a message to Abraham after these things. And you get to verse 23, and Bethuel begot Rebekah. What was the name of Isaac's wife? When you obeyed God, Abraham was willing to sow hundreds and hundreds of miles away. There's a word release, and someone starts running. They start running toward Abraham. I gotta get this word to Abraham, who has a son, Isaac, that Rebekah has been born. Hallelujah to his great name. Hundreds and hundreds of miles, someone comes running. And for us to see the cosmic plan of God, you got to go back. You have to go forward to see how God is working things together for good, for those who love him and for those who are called according to his purpose. I know my time is up, but I got to get this out because it's like fire in my belly. In the book of Matthew, it says the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of Abraham, the son of David. And Abraham begat Isaac. And Isaac begat Jacob. And Jacob begat Judah. And Judah, it goes on. Judah begat Hezron. Hezron begat Ram. And Ram begat Abinadab. And Abinadab begat Nashon. And Nashon begat Salmon. And Salmon begat Boaz. And Boaz begat Obed. And Obed begat Jesse. And so in all this, and Jesse begot David. And all this, there are kings being released. The messianic line is now being forged. And God is getting ready. He's preparing for the coming of the Messiah. And Abraham doesn't see how God is working out. Abraham does not see the impact of his seed. He does not see what God is doing. But even though God is moving and Abraham is not seeing, it does not mean that God is not moving on behalf of those who are operating in faith. I want you to know, for those who are bewildered and you don't know how things are going to work out, I encourage you right now to obey whatever the Holy Spirit is telling you, because there might be many people who will miss out. But that one widow in Zarephath who says, I'm willing to trust, Jesus says, if you give two mites and if you are giving your life, there is more that is being released in your life. Stand to your feet. I'm so done right now. Thank you, Jesus. God is faithful. He is good. He watches over his word to perform. And Heavenly Father, we thank you, bless you, and we love you. Lord, and we thank you for calling us according to your purpose. We thank you, Lord, for the flow of your grace that has been released. And through obedience, we step into it. We trust you with our lives. We trust you with all that we are. we're not going to lean and we're not going to put our weight on what we know, because in and of ourselves, we are inadequate at best. But Lord, you are faithful. And so what little we might have, we say right now, we're going to trust you with it. We're going to believe you. We're going to stand on your word and obey you in the name of Jesus. If you have not given Jesus Christ your life and you're still holding on to it, what are you doing? Are you planning to save yourself? Are you planning to put yourself in heaven? No, you can't. But he loves you. He loves you so much that it's not that he was about to offer his son. He actually did it because he loves you. Free gift. What you and I do, we say yes. We say, I receive it. I receive your love. And when you do that, he comes in and he makes all things new. Some of you, your life is getting old. Same old, same old. What are you into? What is it, your career? Is that what your life is about, your career? You're created to have a relationship with your Creator. He that comes to God must believe that he is. Some of you, your hearts are hungry and you say, yes, I believe, I believe. That's God, that's all he's looking for. It's for you to get to the place where you say, I believe and I will obey. I say, yes. That's you. Just raise your hand to heaven. No one's going to embarrass you. But that's saying, I don't care what anybody thinks. And I admit that I need Jesus and I need saving. Hallelujah to his great name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just say yes, 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 yes to the Holy Spirit of God. Backslider, say yes. Stop caring about people. They don't have a heaven or hell to send you. Say yes. Thank you, Lord. And join me in this. Even those of you online, join me in this. Heavenly Father, I thank you for sending your son. I believe that you died, that you were buried, and that you rose again on the third day. I admit that I have sinned and fallen short of your glory, but I'm asking you now to forgive me, cleanse me, wash me through your precious blood. I receive you as my Lord, my Master, my owner, and my Savior. I renounce the devil and all of his works, and I give my life to you totally and completely in Jesus' name. If you prayed that, you've made the first step. Now keep on stepping. Get into a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church. The Word, Prayer, Church, Witnessing, and Giving, make that your lifestyle. And your relationship will continue to grow, grow, and grow until you meet Jesus face to face. That's God's plan for your life. Enter in to the plan of God. Heavenly Father, we thank you and bless you for what you've done in our midst as we leave this place and not your presence. May no evil befall us, no plague, accident, mishap of any kind come near us. May all of us reach our destination safely and come back in the fullness of the blessing of the gospel of Christ, but the testimony of leading someone to Jesus and bringing them to church with us. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace in Jesus' name. Wheaton Christian Center, isn't Jesus wonderful? If you need prayer, healing in your body, you made a decision for Christ, or you want to be baptized in water, or you want to join Wheaton Christian Center Church, or you want to be filled with the Holy Ghost, whatever your need, do not leave without your spiritual need met. The pastors are here. ministers are here.